What are we going to do as a church? Our souls need to wake up. We need to respond to the gospel of Jesus. He said, go into the world.
We don't want to deal with reality, Christian. We don't even want to deal with reality, even though we've been saved from this place.
I'm calling on you today in the name of Jesus to rise up to the call of God. Christ is coming back soon.
If I start telling people about hell, I might just scare them off. Where are you going to scare them off to? Hell number two? People, stop and think about it. If hell really exists, and it does, I didn't say that Jesus did, then don't you think people need to know about it? Can't you at least give them a fighting chance? Or are you just going to sit there and let them burn?
Good night. This is Chris from Don't Let Them Burn. Welcome to our show. You can find us at www.don'tletthemburn.com. You can find us on Twitter, Facebook, at the same Don't Let Them Burn. Just want to encourage you tonight through these times that we're going through. And as I wait for my brother Rory to join us, I'll lead you into this episode, which is encouragement in the last days. Well, a lot of things have been happening over the last couple weeks, months, years, that if you're inclined to hear the truth, see the truth as it is according to Bible prophecy, things are shaping up fast to lead to wars, financial decline. Yeah, of course, you can see the moral corruption or the moral decay in this country we call America and around the world. Christians are getting persecuted much more now than yesterday or the year before that. It's rising. And, you know, it could send some of us into a frenzy or, you know, well, Jesus, you know, he told us that these things will happen. And of course they will, you know. What are we going to do? Are we going to be afraid? Are we going to panic, you know, sell all our clothes or our houses and move to the mountains? Or are we going to get out there and preach the word of God? Are we going to try to save more souls before the worst comes? You know, a lot of things building up. We have Russia sending troops into Syria. We have them sending aircrafts over there. You know, they say they're going to go up against ISIS, but you know, they're really going up against something else. You know, if you've been reading what's been going on, you know, find out that America had something to do with ISIS coming into power. But that's on a side note. The point is, how are you going to be encouraged in these last days? How are you going to reach out to people? You know, Jesus told us, the Bible tells us to encourage one another, to basically be each other's comforter, so that when the hard times come, we're able to endure. We're able to, you know, we were told that we're going to have problems in this life. We're going to go through tribulation. So we have regular things that we go through in life, and we have things that we didn't expect. We have hurricanes, we have earthquakes, and tsunamis, and all sorts of things. But the point is, the end is coming, and Jesus Christ is coming soon. So we must be on our guard, one, not to be deceived, because there's a lot of deception out there, coming from a many directions, whether it be religious or political, food, entertainment. Deception is everywhere. There's one documentary I watched called The Age of Deceit. Exactly what this is, the age of deceit. So you don't want to be deceived, and that's one of the first things that Jesus told his disciples. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. And you don't want to deceive yourself. You know, if you're saved, there's ways to deceive yourself. If you're not saved and thinking that you're okay, you're definitely deceiving yourself even more. A greater tragedy, because you'll end up in hell and later on in the lake of fire. And you don't want to be deceived that way, thinking that you're okay, thinking that your money will save you, gold or the ammunition that you stock up, the food that you stock up, friends that you have, the belief that you have, being self-righteous, you know? So these are hard things to think about. Some of them are easy to think about. Some of them are practical to think about. And you just don't want to be in the corner of deception. You know, you have kids gunning each other down in schools, in the streets, and gangs, drug use is on a high. You know, I could name many things. Hello?
Yes, hello. Can you hear me?
How are you doing?
Good. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord.
All right. So, we had a little technical difficulty. The show is actually being heard live. So, it's sort of a situation like that. So, we just keep going and run it all through the whole program.
Okay.
All right. So, I was talking about the Russian troops and military in Syria. And I talked about a couple other things, but I was just giving some bullet points.
Yeah. There's a lot of things going on in our world today.
It might be our connection.
Okay. Is that better now or what? Is that better?
Go ahead, you gotta keep
Hello?
Talking.
Yeah.
Yeah, keep
what
talking.
I was saying is that things are changing quite rapidly in our world today. But we, as Christians, can't lose hope. Yes, we hear, like some of the things that you pointed out, Russian troops, Russian sending troops to China, sending troops to Syria, and also some of the other things that are going on. China's warships off the coast of Alaska, things of that nature. But we can't lose heart. We got to trust in the Lord and lean not onto our own understanding. You know, that's what the Word says. And I'm just so encouraged by the Word of God that, you know, we are to look up. Our redemption draws nigh. It's near. He's coming. The King is coming. And all we have to do is prepare the way for the Lord. Amen?
Amen. Well.
Amen.
I was basically saying, you know, for you not to be deceived, either by yourself or the teachers that are out there, or thinking that this world is going to turn into a utopia. Right?
Yeah, and it's not. And, you know, the enemy, he's trying to do everything he can do, like you said, to deceive people, to let them think that things can get better, or to let them also think that if we change the president, that it's going to change everything. And it hasn't, and it will not, because it has to go a certain way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It has to go a certain way. Things have to go a certain way in order for them to have this one world order, this new world order. So, you know, America has to come down. And that's what these people are planning. The people
and
in power.
For the listeners, just remember that the New World Order is not something that new. It's been around for a long time. Now you can't even call it a conspiracy theory anymore. It's been said on the news from major leaders and even business owners. So just bear in mind that this thing is coming. But here we're here to encourage you and not depress you.
Exactly.
And here it is, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. So Jesus is the only hope that any of us have, not just to survive, because we're not talking about survival. We're talking about eternal security, eternal eternal relationship with the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So, amen.
You got to keep that in mind. That should be your main focus every day. Who is your safety? Says the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe.
Amen.
Safe.
Amen.
You know?
Amen.
And our bodies are corruptible. Our bodies will die and go back to the earth. We'll get a glorified body when we're with God. But in hell, what kind of body will you have? You're going to feel pain. You're going to feel pain. So think about that. You know, something. So a body that dies forever. That's something to really think hard about. And here we're Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Straight.
Amen.
So he won't bring you
Amen.
off the path. He won't bring you onto a path that winds around the mountains. He will bring you straight through the mountains of despair, the mountains of tribulation, the mountains of the end time, mountains of deception. But you have to keep your focus on the Lord. And once you take your eyes off of him, things go wrong in your life. Things go, you know, and that doesn't promise that you're going to have the smooth ride in your life. It's just saying that he will guide your path. So, it's the same thing today. You know, we have wars in different countries, and the Christians that, some of the stories that come from over there, not just of wars, but just persecution, is they're dying with joy. They're dying burnt in fire, but with joy, and they're proclaiming the gospel of Jesus anyway. I don't think a lot of us, including me, understand what that is, understand that type of joy of the Lord. You know? Because a lot of us are growing up in situations where, you know, the streets rule and this, that, and the other, and, you know, we have that mindset in us. Kill or be killed, you know? Or
Amen.
The mindset of you know, retaliation or revenge. Yeah, even some Christians, yes. We have that mindset. The mindset of the old man, the new man. And we should continually have the mindset of one Christ, which is the one that sanctifies you, your new man, your new mind, your renewing your mind. And to
Amen.
Have you're supposed to have love enough for your enemies. So when they're coming to get you, you know, for you to be witnessing to them through tragedy. Yeah? I mean,
Amen.
Yeah, we're going to protect our families and, you know, and all these good things. But at the same time, are we trying to bring a soul with us to heaven? You know? That's my 2 cents right now, Rory. Want to pick up on that?
Yeah, I listen to what you're saying, and it is so important that as people we don't, like you said, we can't lose hope. We have to trust in the Lord. He's our strong tower. We have to really press in now. As Christians, this is where we have to really seek out God for ourselves, because this is not a time for us to just give up or quit or lose hope, you know. I thought about some of the things you said. I thought about, you know, a lot of people say, well, this is all a conspiracy. It's all fake. It's not real. But the Bible, the Word of God, is so real. It is true. You know.
Yeah.
It is so meaningful. It is so meaningful. Psalms 2 says, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The peoples imagine a vain thing. The kings of the earth set themselves up, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us cast their bands asunder. Let us cast their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heaven shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Why I read that is because our hope is in the Lord. And he says in his word, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And as Christians tonight, we really got to focus on God. Focus on him. Focus on his word. Really press in. See who he is. Learn who he is for yourself. Come to a deeper understanding that we will want to trust in him. Hold on to him. Let him be our source. Let him be our source so that we are able to do the things that he has called us to do. People are out there dying in this world. People don't have a way. They don't know who God is for themselves. They don't know. But what we can do, we can show them. We can share with them. And it doesn't. We don't have to go out on the street corner and preach. But if each one of us would go out and try to reach one, just reach one person for the Lord, it would make a difference. It would make a huge difference. Amen, my brother?
Amen. Yeah. At some point, you know, the Bible gives a lot of ways to encourage you and for us to encourage ourselves using the Word of God.
Amen.
Yeah. And it's important that Christians stand together in these times because some of us are the lone wolves thinking that we could do without the pack, thinking that we can do without going to church or being around other Christians.
Yeah. And that's a lie of the enemy. That's a lie of the enemy.
It's a lie. You know, yeah, exactly. And of course, you know, in every congregation, there are members that one aren't saved or two aren't spiritually mature. So they're going to give off bad characteristics. But the point is to help each other grow and help each other with our stress through these times because, you know, when the Supreme Court decision was passed, many people was like, oh, I didn't see this one coming. Yeah, we saw it coming. I didn't see it coming as quick, but I saw it coming, you know? But for the people that weren't, you know, keeping their ear to the ground, so to speak, they were caught by surprise. And, you know, they went, you know, kind of not crazy, but, you know, they were kind of like, you know, distressed. And but they didn't have other people to lean on that had the knowledge that they needed to give them that encouragement. You know?
Right.
I mean, here in John 14:27, it says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Jesus. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid.
Amen.
That one line right there is a strong word. Because we're supposed to have the peace of the Lord, the peace of Jesus.
But
and he says, the world gives you.
Well, how do you get that peace? How does that come? Do you live like the world? Do you live like the world?
I didn't hear you. Sorry.
I said, do you live like the world? You can't. You have to follow the word of the living God. That's the only way. That is the only way. That we have to delve into his word, we have to seek him for ourselves, and we have to have a relationship with him.
Yeah.
And that's what the Lord wants.
And here,
amen.
Here in John, yes, amen. Here in John 16:33, it says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. Let me say that again. I have told you these things so that in me you will have peace. Jesus talking. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world.
Amen.
So a lot of these things that we're fearing have already been overcome. He's already won. We're fearing financial collapse. We're fearing martial law. We're fearing
all sorts of wars and things like that. Chinese troops caught on our shores, off the shores of, I think, Alaska. All sorts of things. I could just go back and go through the headlines.
Yeah,
and you'll see there's things coming onto America, but a lot of us are in fear.
But not only that, people are also deluded. People are just totally deluded. Everybody goes around their business, and it's just, hey, just as we did things before. No one is seeking God, and that's what we got to call to do. Seek the Lord. Seek Him while He may be found.
Amen.
You know, my brother, we got to seek Him.
And
not only do we have to seek Him, but now for everyone else, for those of us who are followers of Christ, we have to press in, find out who He really is for ourselves. We can't wait for other people to say, well, this is who Christ is to me. No, we have to know Him for ourselves. You know? We have to know Him for ourselves. And tonight, we just cry out for America. We cry out for the people in America. Cry out for those that are lost. We are the only ones that are standing between them and hell.
We're the ones praying and standing between all of this evil. And even though many of us are getting killed off in other countries, people just understand that the same thing that's happening over there is coming here, and it's here actually. It's here.
Yeah.
Somebody got thrown in jail. A woman, I can't remember her name right now, for just being, just standing up for her beliefs in Jesus Christ. Thrown in jail. So it's serious, and people think this is coming later than sooner. This sort of climate, we're still supposed to keep our joy, keep our peace. And I know it's hard for us to understand what that means. But if you look through history of the Christian martyrs, the ones that have been burnt at the stake or eaten alive, many, many different ways that the Christians died in the past, they died with joy. They died praising God. They died giving signal to the other Christians that were around them, watching them die. And this should encourage us to pray for our enemies and to be victorious along with Jesus. And remember that Paul wrote a lot of his letters in prison.
Yes.
In the rat-infested prison. And he was full of joy, and he was telling the people on the outside to have joy, peace, the joy of the Lord, the peace of the Lord, the comfort. The Holy Spirit is with us. He's our comforter.
Amen.
And sometimes we take ourselves out into our own stress, whether it be daily lives or the things coming up on us or the things that are happening. We take ourselves out of that peace just by thinking about it too much. Instead of focusing on God, we focus on these terrible things or these life situations, you know. But here in this show, we're focusing on, we're talking about the things going on around the world. The Iran deal with America, with a nuclear arm. That's something to take note of. That's something serious. And people have to understand that these are really, this is not a question anymore. Are we in the end times? It's not a question anymore. That's what's going on. And we've got to stay encouraged, because we're not appointed to the wrath of God. We're not supposed to endure these massive, bold judgments and things that are going to come upon the people that hate God. But before all of that comes, we have to endure until we
we get raptured or we die. You know? So what is your goal? What is your everyday goal out there? I mean, a lot of us like to look in the Bible prophecy, which is a good thing, but sometimes we don't pay attention to our lives. When I say our lives, our daily life, our kids, our, you know, the things that God has given to us to take care of. And we get off on a track of, oh, the world is collapsing, you know? Yet we have things, we have responsibilities to take care of. You know, with these date setters that were back in the day, in the 1800s, in the 1900s, even now, today, we have date setters. And these people would go and sell their houses, all their possessions, and go up into the mountain and wait for Jesus to come. Jesus didn't show up because the Bible says no man knows the date or the hour. So they were deceived. They were deceived.
Right.
And we cannot allow ourselves to be deceived, especially by a false prophet, a false teacher, or anyone that propagates those type of things. Because if you're reading your Bible, if you're studying it for yourself, or if you're on the good, reading it for yourself and being taught by a good minister in a group of Christians, you should be on point every time. You should know
right.
to stay away from. So,
and that's one aspect of it too. But the other thing is that just being led by the Holy Spirit is also critical. The Holy Spirit will also lead you. So, something that I noticed, you always have people setting dates that's going to go on. The dates for when they think that Christ will return. However, the only thing that we have to do, and the Lord never told us a day, He said, just watch and pray. Watch and pray. That's what we're called to do, is just to watch and keep praying and just seeking after God. And that's the most important thing.
And he also called them
hypocrites. Don't look for a date. Go ahead.
I was saying he also called them hypocrites for not knowing the season. Because
exactly.
we do know the season. We just don't know the exact day of his return.
Right.
So it's just a thing where don't let yourself listen to like 15 people that are and all of them are talking something different. It's like, well, who do I listen to? All of them can't be right. Unless they're on one accord, right? So the people that are setting these dates, are, first of all, they already had something wrong with their teaching anyway, you know? So if the person isn't discerning, they'll just get led in all types of directions. And some of them go crazy because they hear a whole lot of nothing that they think is a whole lot of something, you know? So I'm just saying, be careful. I mean, some of the Bible teachers I listen to, they might vary on certain subjects, but they're pretty solid. I mean, I don't go off into, when I hear something weird from maybe one of them, I don't go off into that area, you know?
Right.
But when I hear some really weird things coming out of their mouth, I'm like, I'm good. I'm not listening to that anymore because it doesn't align with the Word of God. You know, because some people chase rabbit trails and some people may have an interesting idea, you know, but I'm more interested in, does it line up with the Word of God? Does the Bible say that?
Okay.
You know? So and dealing with the subject that we're dealing today, the end times, the last days, that's why people have to be very careful. Because this is not like a subject that came up in the last 50 years, you know? It's been since the disciples, since, you know, the apostles. Because they were out there preaching the Word of God because they thought, you know, Jesus was coming back sooner than anybody thought, you know? So the last days, as we know it, lines up with a lot of things that are prophesied in the Bible. Things to come, even, you know, I'm watching this thing with Russia sending the troops over to Syria. It's getting very interesting. So I'm not going to say what it is. You know, I'm just watching. You know, so is there anything that's come up in the news that you've that interests your eye today that people might be fearful of?
Well, yes, there are a lot of things that are in the news today, and this is I got it from. It's actually called the website is called Contending for the Truth, and one of the things that we see that's happening, the spirit of lawlessness is coming on America. Lawlessness, because for the first time we see police are being shot at, we see police are being killed. So we see that you know, they've come up with this this movement called Black Lives Matter. And just the same, a couple of days ago on Block Talk Radio, one of the men came out and said, it's about time we started shooting police officers. Now,
wow.
Yes, he came out and he said that, a black man. And listen, that can't be right. And that is frightening. He's saying we're going to start picking them off. That was a quotation, picking them off, just like how the lions would pick off a buffalo, just picking off. And I looked at that and I said, my Lord, how we have gone so far, how we have gone so far. Now, listen, Chris, and you and I, we have talked about this. Listen, when a police officer does something wrong, it's wrong. There's a way to go about it. But you cannot take law or the law into your hand to satisfy your own needs. Whether it's you're black, you're white, you're Hispanic, you're brown, you're blue, doesn't matter. All lives matter. All lives matter. All lives matter to Jesus Christ. And it's so unfortunate that now people are resorting to this garbage. And when you hear them, when you hear the young black men talking, you know, all I can say is I'm totally astonished. I'm astonished when you hear, they say, hey, it doesn't matter now. We need to do this. We need to start killing them. How do you say that? How could you do that? How could you stoop so low? No, that's not the way to do something. And we are looking, we are seeing that things have changed dramatically. I wouldn't say drastically, I'd say dramatically. It has changed dramatically. And he's calling for people to arms. And that's not the only one. He's not the only one. Louis Farrakhan said he needs people to start going and killing them before they kill us. What type of thing is that? It's a race war that these people are stoking. They're stoking those fires. And listen, Jesus Christ died already. He died for all of this. For all of this. And that's one of the things that really it shocked me to hear them saying that. It shocked me that these men can spew this venomous hate. You know?
Yeah, let me align something that with you. All right, so this movie straight out of Compton just came out, right?
Yeah. Same
and thing. This movie is basically showing the life of NWA and their legacy, right? I didn't watch the movie, but I grew up on that music, so I know what the energy it brings, you know?
Yeah.
And what a friend pointed out to me is it's so interesting the time they brought the movie out, right? And then he said where he lived that he, for the first time in his whole life, he's hearing cars drive by playing NWA loud. And one of those songs, of course, is F the Police.
Mm-hmm.
So it's so interesting of how the climate is rising. And I mean, I can't tell you if it's an Illuminati plot or anything like that. All I'm saying is, it's interesting how when all of this increase in racial tension is brought out, that this same group that was also put on a pedestal by Daddy Bush and also brought in by the corporate leaders at the time to put this gangster music out, is now being pushed in front of our young people again. And the increase in the people that want to hear
at
this
particular point in time. At this particular point in time.
Their interest has risen for it now. Again.
Yeah.
We are dealing with a society that's already intensified with this racial tension that's going on.
Yeah.
Looking at this movie and bringing the garbage into their cars and playing it again. Not that there wasn't garbage in their car before, but this going back to the early 90s, late 80s, and this evil that was coming out. I mean, they're going to say that, oh, we're just speaking about the street lessons and stuff like that. If you listen to the music, you understand there's a message going on.
No,
it's not just about the street experiences. I'm sorry. It's more than that going on there. And one of the leaders, Eazy-E, he recited Aleister Crowley stuff.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I'm not going to believe that for one.
Listen, these things don't surprise me at all. It doesn't surprise me at all. Does not surprise me at all. At all. What's going on? And to see them, like you said, to reinvent it and push it out there again, that's critical.
Recycle,
and it's pushing it for the next generation to come. And it is so vile, so rude. It is so dark. Remember, Eazy-E, he died of AIDS because of what. How these guys were living, you know. And if you don't believe what I'm saying, look around NWA. All that comes from that, or that genre of music, was death. That's the spirit
in
of
fact,
death and anarchy.
Yeah, in fact, if there wasn't an NWA, there wouldn't have been this rise in gangster music that happened throughout the 90s up till now. It wouldn't have happened because that was the biggest group back then that did that. Everything else was on the ground, and the corporate leaders, the guy that was running the company with them, they helped propagate this whole thing, and it made the other music, I guess you could call it so-called positive, go back on the ground. This became the thing that was more popular. So now I'm just saying, now that it's brought back out and people are playing it, and they even have a promotion on I think either Instagram or one of those places where you say it's straight out of and you name what it is. So here you are promoting the movie, which you're straight out of whatever, you know, and you're getting other people more interested in it. And the movie actually, what's funny is the movie is doing better than a lot of other movies. I mean, number one for like 3 weeks. Why?
Right.
Nothing special
about
it.
Because it spews filth. It spews garbage. The other thing I want to talk about, Chris, is that the person who was over NWA, most people don't remember, Suge Knight. Suge Knight was one of those key guys in,
that was Death Row.
Well, Death Row, but...
That was Death Row, that's after.
Another way. That's after. Let me put it here this way. All of that same group came out of here. Suge Knight took on, what's his name? He took off one of the guys from NWA. He did.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys were killers.
Well, what happened? Let me backtrack a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Suge Knight, basically, he after NWA was dying out, he came up with Death Row, which Dr. Dre went with him. So he didn't have anything really to do with NWA. But
no, right. That's what I meant.
One of the leaders,
I'm sorry. Yes.
The production,
right.
The producer went with Suge Knight, and then they made that thing with Snoop Dogg and Dog Pound and all these other groups. And basically, that was like an NWA 2 in a sense, or you know, whatever.
Exactly. More garbage.
But it was intensified. It was intensified by then. The music was it got more graphic and all this other stuff. And
right.
Of course, the young kids gravitated towards it like today. But back to the movie again, it's like with the promotion of these Instagram messages and all these other things, what's going on is it's also trying to start a division again through territory. Because remember back in the 90s with Tupac and Biggie, there was this big East Coast, West Coast, and many people,
exactly.
even innocent, died because of it.
Exactly.
People were assassinated, literally, you know, because of the whole thing with these two people that are now dead and gone to maybe hell. I don't know, but they weren't saved as far as I know. But anyway.
They come to know Jesus Christ. That's the only thing I can say.
Yeah.
That's the only thing
exactly.
I can say. If they didn't, maybe I'm their dying bed, they
came
to
know
him.
Christ, they're in hell. So.
Exactly.
I can't remember the boxer's name. I think it was Holyfield. Who's the one that came out with the little thing the machine that toasts or makes the grill? Foreman. He told a story about talking to Tupac about salvation. And basically George Foreman. And basically the story came down to this. Tupac was like, I know all this. I know, you know, but I'm having too much fun right now. And that was that was before he died. Not too long before he died. You get what I'm saying? So, people, this whole thing with the racial tension, it's coming from different angles, and here is another piece of deception that's coming towards people. And, again, if you're saved, you got to be encouraged in the Lord. You have
yes,
to
and for those... I'm sorry, my dear brother. And for those children,
go ahead.
Those young kids, maybe you're surfing the internet tonight and you might be 14, 15, 16, 18, I don't know. Turn that garbage off. Turn it off. It's not good for you.
Yeah.
It doesn't benefit you. It's the music of death and destruction.
If you're a Christian listening to this type of music, I would say turn it off, because you're done with poison in your mind and you're shrinking your growth. Not just spiritually, but as a man or a woman, you're shrinking your growth. You're stunting your growth. I know this because that's what happened to me. So, you know, you got to be careful what you're putting in your ear. But, you know, turn to who you call your Savior. Turn to Jesus. Because if you call him your Savior and you're putting in this junk, you're not honoring him. Because I know for sure every song has many words that we can't even say on the air right now. And many
exactly.
subject matters. You know, I listen to it, so I know. You know, I'm not just somebody that's sitting at the
corner, you know, Chris,
and making an assumption. I know this, you know? So
While we're talking about this, I think there should be one night where we do a show on this.
Say again?
We need to do a show on rap music.
Oh, yes, we will. We will. And this is a part of the whole last days, you know, worshiping the Antichrist thing. It might not seem like that at the forefront, but in the end, it's all about Satan. So it's leading to worshiping of the Antichrist. You know,
and it has its own Bible, too.
Say again? I
was saying that it has its own Bible. Hip hop has its own Bible.
You said
most people don't
Bible?
Know that. Yes, hip hop has its own Bible.
Well, yeah, hip hop has its own Bible, and you know it is a religion, and we're going to do a whole show on that. Well, you know, not to get off basis of the encouragement, you know.
Right.
We're going to try to encourage you to not follow the trends of society, because the trends of society
Amen.
Are leading. Kids astray, you know. This movie that came out—I mean, come on—it's like I thought it was gonna fly under the radar like every other hip hop movie that comes out, and this one blew up. You know? know, it made a lot of money. I'm not sure of the figure right now, but, you know, we got to avoid these things, you know? You got to avoid them because they plant seeds in your mind. And they adjust your attitude without you knowing.
Yep.
This is just part of the teaching that we did in Pull Them From the Fire. But moving along, I just want to, you know, keep encouraging you to withstand in these days. Yes, the racial tension is real. Yes, cops are killing black men, women for...
No, I wouldn't say cops. I wouldn't say the word cops because it's not all cops. But I'm saying cops out there have made some grave errors. Right. You know, that's made some grave error. Police officers. But, you know, for those that do, there are many more that uphold the law. This morning I was driving in my vehicle, and I was driving too fast, and the cop just looked at me and said, hey, slow down a little bit, slow down. You know, and I tooted my horn and said, thanks. That's the reason why they're there. But there are some that are rogue, that have misused power, that have taken the power and just didn't do the right thing with it. You know what I'm saying? But that's not all police officers. That's not all of them. They're not all the same. You know? But does that mean we should throw out all cops? No. Definitely not. It's just so unfortunate that they have allowed, and I would have to go as far as saying from all the way up top, all the way down, they have allowed this to go on. No one has come out in support of the police officers and said, hey, we support you. You know, those that have done wrong, they should be prosecuted beyond a shadow of a doubt. And they should not use the law to keep them doing wrong. Hey, man.
Hello there. Hello.
Yeah, man.
I'm back.
Okay. So I'm just talking about the police officers, you know, and just wanting to support them and.
Okay. I didn't get to hear any of it, so, but.
No problem.
Let's just there are many things that are going to surprise some of the listeners when they happen. Stuff that we've heard of. And don't be caught off guard spiritually.
Amen.
Don't be caught off guard spiritually. Get serious with the Lord now. Not when things happen. Well, I remember when 9/11 happened, everybody flooded the churches. They didn't care what denomination.
Yep.
All the churches were flooded with people. 30 days later, went back to the same old thing. Same old thing, you know? So they had a spiritual experience. They thought the world was going to end. And they went into church thinking maybe they were safe, you know? Thinking they are seeking God, but they went in there with a stone heart. At least some of them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And only God knows how many people got saved because of that situation. Could have been many, could have been a little bit. It could have swung both ways, you know? Either way, I mean. So don't get caught off by the situations that happen in this world. And at the same time, if you're unsaved, you could die tonight, tomorrow, the next day, 30 seconds from now. So are you going to keep gambling with your eternal salvation, you know?
Amen.
But that's just one thing I wanted to touch right there, just to get somebody's ear. But it says to cast your cares on the Lord, and He will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. Let me say that again. Cast your cares upon the Lord. He will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. That's Psalm 52, verse 22. Guys, I got some interference going on there. Is that you?
Sorry.
Rory?
Yeah.
casting your cares. There's so many verses in the Bible that let you know that believers, Christians, the righteous are protected in a sense. Because I don't want to give a false statement, but you're protected. But God would allow certain things to happen for His glory. I think that's the way I can say it there. You know, because of course, obviously, Christians are getting murdered and put in jail, things like that. But told you these things will happen, and it will glorify Him, because they're not doing it to you per se. They're doing it against Jesus. And if you understand that, then you'll have a wider picture of everything. But the Lord protects, sustains in your daily life, things that you do.
Amen. And
your stress, the stress that you go through, you say it won't make you fall with strong words. Okay? You will. In Isaiah 26:3, it says, "You will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast. Trust you." You trust the Lord, so you should. He's going to keep your mind. He's going to help you to have the peace that you need. I mean, so many verses. I mean, but we'll continue. You have another hour. You know. Call all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. 1 Peter 5:7. Cast all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. So any problems that come up, whether it be in the world or in your personal life, bring it to the Lord. Now remember, He answers in three ways: yes, no, and maybe. And remember that some of these problems are causing you too. Wow, what was that? Some of these problems are passed on you because of your wrongdoing. You didn't take care of what you needed to take care of. But as far as the situations coming up in the world, being spiritually ready, that means praying to the Lord. That means getting your spirit man built up so that you can stand in time of trouble. Because many people will go crazy. If California was to fall off into the coast right now, how many people would lose their minds, even though they've been told for generations that this is going to happen? You know?
Yeah.
When the hurricanes came and took out the Gulf over there in Louisiana, you know, some people went crazy. They weren't prepared. They weren't spiritually prepared. A lot of people died. So these things are going to happen all over the world. We saw when the tsunami took out Myanmar. You know, we heard word over here. And it was just disastrous. And that was a small tsunami, actually. That was a baby. Nothing. You know? The earthquakes in Chile. Earthquakes here and there. Jesus said you would have earthquakes in diverse places. Diverse places. You got to give God glory when you're taken out of those situations. Maybe you were headed to Myanmar on a flight and something said not go, or a situation came up where you couldn't go. Maybe you were headed to Haiti before the earthquakes happened and something just said don't go. You know? So you got to praise God for His grace.
Amen. And His mercy.
I mean, Some of the unbelievers don't understand that they're given time. They're being given more time to turn to the Lord, but they refuse to listen. I hope you don't refuse to listen, whoever you are that's unsaved listening to this program. Don't refuse. The Lord is calling you. Answer Him. Even if you have to say, God, if you're real, you know, those sort of things, just cry out to Him. A lot of people out there broken, and things happen to them in their lives. Cry out to the Lord. He will answer you. With a sincere heart. Not just, oh, if you're real. No, that type of attitude. A heart of really reaching out to the Lord. You know? No matter if you believe me and Rory or any other person that talks about the end times and things that are coming, it's coming. Even if you don't believe us, the truth is not going to be changed by your belief.
Exactly. By your belief. You know? If you believe not, or you believe so.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And yeah, because, I mean, a person will come up and say, come up to the person and say, you know what, I know this about you, and I know that about you, and I know that about you. And you'll be like, what, really, you do? But you don't know all along a demon was telling them that stuff. That's how some of these people do it. It has nothing to do with a special power or anything. They're speaking with spirit, you know? Or, you know, you go to some reader and they tell you about yourself. You'll believe them before you believe what the Creator said happened, you know? And unfortunately, some Christians are getting caught up in this too. But this is going to be widespread in the last days. Hello? They're going to be worshiping demons out in front of you, in the open. It won't be hidden anymore. That's how bad the environment is going to get. The climate, the spiritual climate is going to get that bad. And you might think, oh, well, that's maybe 50, 100 years from now, but it's happening right now in Miami. It's happening right now in some other places. People are actually putting out their idols, the trash bags of their last night's sacrifice to whoever. Happening right now in broad daylight. So only God knows how much longer it's going to take for it to get worse. And things are getting worse rapidly, rapidly. But for the Christian, how many people are you going to help to go to heaven, to be with the Lord? How many people are you going to spread the gospel to? Isn't that what's more important than the fear of an earthquake, or the fear of death, or the fear of a fire in your house, or cops beating you up, or whatever it may be, whatever the situation is? You see, a lot of us are stunted in our spiritual growth, and we can't, or we refuse to get out of it sometimes. Sometimes we don't want to listen to the unction of God, when God prompts us to read the Bible or to listen to something that's holy. You know, we get caught up in our entertainment and our video games and our lives and our things that we shouldn't be doing. We get caught up in that more than things of God. And that's another reason why we get caught off guard. Discipline is lacking. And I'm not going to sit here and act like I have the best discipline. My discipline is lacking too. You know? So I'm preaching to myself too. So it's just a thing of, when are we going to get serious? Because so many things are laid out in the Bible, from the beginning, the middle, to the end of our Jesus Christ returns, through the thousand-year millennium, to the white throne judgment. So many things are laid out for us to understand, but we don't take time to get into the Word, get into what God is saying to us. We just need to really take charge of our spiritual life, and with the leading of the Holy Spirit, and just grow.
My comfort,
grow. Because right now, a nuclear bomb is not anywhere in this country.
Thank you and praise you for all of you.
What would happen? Panic.
Panic.
You know, people would panic. So what then?
Able to, by your word, be preserved.
And we got some technical difficulties over here with interference. Try to just look at it. So, All I'm saying is we have to get into our Bible. We have to get into the Word. We have to be steadfast, moving with the Lord, walking with the Lord, and let the Spirit guide us in our daily lives. Certain things happen, and you get caught up in the moment, and then within 3 days, it dissipates. But what if that thing comes that doesn't dissipate? What if the whole reality of this nation changes, or the world changes? What then? Into the Word of God. Are you there, Rory? Let me look up this other verse here that I had pulled up. And the Lord is my strength. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tent of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. Psalm 118, 14 through 16. What if you spent more time rejoicing, giving praise to the Lord than having anxiety, being depressed over things that we were told were going to happen? He told us to have a good heart about these things because the end is coming and He is coming back soon. So,
amen.
You know, I just want to show you that there's no reason to freak out about these things. Don't be distressed about these things. I mean, yeah, sure, if you want to prepare to protect your family from certain things that might happen, nothing wrong with that. But don't let that be the constant motivation for every day. Because then you start lacking in what you need. Stand when that time comes. Or you'll start thinking.
Sorry about all the noise, my dear brother.
Say again, please.
Sorry about all the noise.
Oh, okay. No problem. Okay, so I don't know if you heard everything I said, but you wanted to add anything to that?
Well, I was reading some passages of scripture, and I went earlier on and saw this movie. It's called War Room. It's a great movie. Yes, it's excellent movie. Excellent. Why am I saying this movie now at this point in time? Because it talks about praying and the importance of prayer in the life of a Christian. It is so vital to our survival. It is so vital that we pray, that we seek God for who He is. It is vital for all of us to come under the banner of Jesus Christ now and start praying. We can't wait anymore. Everybody needs to find Him, seek Him, and find Him. Because things are getting critical. Things are getting very crucial. And as Christians, this is what we're called to do. This is what we're called to do. Is it better or is it worse now? I'm sorry, my dear brother. I'm trying to get a better location.
It might just be on my end. I don't know, because I think other people can hear you, but this is
really
bad on my end.
Well, I'm just telling you, I'm just trying to encourage everybody to just seek the Lord. The time has come now for us to seek Him. The time has come now for us to get to know who He is. The time has come now. It's time for us to be serious. It's time for us to get into our war rooms and start praying to the Lord and asking Him to preserve our lives. You know, are you trusting in the stock market? Are you trusting in the things that you have absolutely no control over? Trust in the Lord. We don't have any control over Him, but He's...
Okay, so it looks like Rory got knocked off there. So I guess he'll be calling back in. So let me continue. And I wasn't able to hear what he was saying, so I hope I don't go off on, you know, a different road. But let me go back to the verses here. He said, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decree." Psalm 119:71. He said, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decree." So this person was obviously afflicted by something that he didn't want to go through, but he was allowed to. And he learned from that, and he learned the decrees of the Lord. And I guess he now went steadfast. He said, "I call on the Lord in my distress, and he answers me." You know, I don't want to act like it's not natural in our human flesh to get a little nervous or to get a little fearful or to, you know, be distressed about something. That's just how our, you know, we're in this fallen world in sinful bodies, and it's going to react to this world, you know, and the things that we're not used to. Just like when anybody goes through some type of trauma, a car accident, a war, gunshot wound, something like that, our body's distressed, you know? And how are you going to react to that distress is what's really going to make the difference. Are you going to give up on life, or are you going to get into the Word and pay attention to God more than the distress? There are people out there that have no arms, no legs. They lost it however they lost it, and they still are going around the world preaching the Word of God. No legs, no arms. Think about that.
Amen.
And some of us have all our limbs,
faculties,
fingers, eyes. You know, some people have lost a lot, and still they're able to pay attention to Jesus. And it's not that they had this perfect thing going on where, oh, this has happened to me, so I'm going to just keep on going with the Lord. It's not just that. You know, they had their time of depression. They had their time of doubt. They had their, you know, questioning their faith. They had that. But the important part is they pressed on.
Amen.
You know, and they worked for the Lord.
Amen.
So there's so many different angles that we can come at with this. Just to tell you that, you know, one, get built up in the Word of God. Two, he promised us many, many things that, first, we're not even supposed to have the spirit of fear. Now, we're not talking about fear of burning your hand on the stove. That's natural fear, okay? But the spirit of fear that comes with the distress of this world, that's not natural. We weren't made to go through all these things, you know?
Amen.
He also tells us to be courageous.
And that's what, and that's the other reason, Chris. That's so much even more that we need to really get into a Word, get into Word of God, pray, seek Him. I keep saying the same thing, but it's so true. He's so real. He doesn't leave you nor forsake you. He says, "I'll make a way for you." And he stands at the door of your heart and he knocks all the time. But are we listening? He wants to reveal himself because he's real. Amen.
You know, and it's so easy to get drunk back into the way that the world thinks because we're grown up programmed with a lot of the thoughts that we think are ours, you know, through the entertainment, through our school system, you know. Different things that we're taught, different family upbringings, and we take that into our Christian lives, whether we know it or not, you know? And that's why it's so easy to sometimes to fall back on the other reactions, you know? But I'm telling you now, as a testament, just if you keep focused on the Lord, I'm telling you, you will not have to be distressed in and just angered or depressed about certain things, you know? If we let that happen,
absolutely.
One, we lose our joy, we lose our peace, and some people, they lose their lives, even as believers, because they let this mountain crumble on them. And you know, I think that's what the enemy wants. He wants you to not be able to stand the day of trials, of tribulation. Especially in these days where he wants to take you away from witnessing. He wants to take you away from being joyful, a witness to another person that's be like, oh, wow, what do they have, you know? Remember, he wants us to be a peculiar people. So that means that somebody's going to look at us and say, wow, what does he have that I don't? You know? There's something peculiar about that person that draws me to them. You want to say, hey, what do you have? You know? Have you ever been sitting somewhere and somebody starts talking to you, then you end up just talking to them about Jesus and they get even more interested because maybe they haven't heard it before? Maybe they've heard of Jesus, but never heard the gospel or heard what Jesus is really about. You know? Now, if you walk around with a strange-looking face all the time, then nobody's going to want to approach you, really. You know? You look all depressed and angry and mad, and you know? So, the joy of the Lord. You know, we should be able to wake up every morning with that joy. And even if you woke up tomorrow and, like I said, something nuclear went off in the country, what if it happened tomorrow morning? What is your first reaction going to be? Is it, praise God, Jesus, you're coming? Or, oh man, this world is going down. What am I going to do? Let me run and try to get money out of the bank. What is it going to be? What's your first reaction going to be? You know? Mm-hmm. Practical things here, you know, and Jesus talks about it. The Bible talks about it. You know, that we don't have, see, the world doesn't know what to do. They don't know where anything is going because, one, they don't know Bible prophecy, and two, they lack the spiritual connection that we have. And that's why we're trying to bring as many people with us as possible.
And the other thing, too, Chris, is that the other thing is that people, not just people, but society on a whole, they've been brainwashed. And, you know, tonight we're just calling you. We're sounding the trumpet. Sounding the trumpet, not for you to be brainwashed anymore. And Jesus is calling. He is calling. And you have to come out of that being carnally minded. You know, like you just said a while ago, if something happens, the man will run and say, give me my money out of the bank because I need to survive. Listen. Money is not important now. Money is not important. Lives are important. Lives are at stake. People are dying. And I say, when people are reading, say, wait, what people, what are you talking about? What people are dying? People are dying. People are dying and going to hell. I don't know who Jesus Christ is. Who will stand up? Who is going to stand up and say, let me be counted. I will share the gospel of Jesus Christ with those that I work with, those that I live with, those around me, those that surround me. You know, that's what we have to do. We have to pray for our neighbors, near and far. We have to pray for all of them, that everybody comes to an understanding of who Christ is for themselves. You know, the men of this world, they who don't follow Christ, the men who don't follow Christ, will tell you about money, finances, and their escape plans, well, how they plan to escape. I read an article the other day, and they're selling land in another country, and how for a certain amount of money, you could get land and live off the grid. But if you live off the grid, and even if all your plans become a total success, you still fail. You still fail if you don't know Jesus Christ. That's why we're here tonight.
Yeah.
That's why we're here tonight. There's no other reason. That's why we're here. Amen?
Yeah, amen. And just as we're talking about hell, there's an interesting passage that's here in Isaiah 5:14. He says, therefore, hell hath enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure, and their glory and their multitude, from another translation. It says, therefore, death opens its jaws, opening wide its mouth. Into it will descend their nobles and masses with all their brawlers and revelers. And, you know, this is more. But, you know, the point is hell is ready for you. It doesn't have. It can't get overflowed and filled up. It's ready for you. If you're there, going with the course of this world, unsaved, rejecting Jesus, it's waiting for you. It's expanding its mouth for the multitude heading into it. And that's not the last place. It's also the lake of fire. That's just a little tidbit for the non-believer, if you're listening. Hell is real. So, you just have to understand that we're trying to save, or trying to help you get saved out of this eternal torment. But that's not the only reason for you to consider or to
serve the Lord.
Go to the calling of Jesus Christ. You know, it's also reconnecting with the creator of the universe. Only God there is. Everything else is false. You relying on yourself, false. Satan did the same thing.
Relying on your own strength.
But this world keeps...
Amen.
Spinning, the world keeps spinning, and the world keeps spinning, and people think that it will just be like that for eons. It will just be like this is. Some people think that when they die, that's it.
And you know, also for those people who are distressed, there are people out there that are distressed. There are people that are hurting. There are people that are crying for whatever reason, whatever your circumstance. I don't know the circumstance, and I don't need to know the circumstance. But God, He's available. And He's available in the sending His Son, Jesus Christ, for that. And He says this in His Word, Psalm 120, verse 1. I call on the Lord in my distress, answers me. Call on the Lord in your distress. Call on Him in your pain, in your anguish. Call on Him, and He said in His Word, He will answer. That's what He said. I didn't say it. And God is not a man that He should lie. To call on the Lord. Amen.
Way to turn people. And we don't want to see you burn. But for the Christian, we don't want to see you in distress. I don't want to be in distress. And the things happen.
Amen.
You know, we've heard a long time about martial law. It's come to America. I say it's coming to America. We've heard that for a long time. And we've heard of FEMA camps, and the red, blue list, the green list, people that would get basically put down, people that would be taken away, all these things. If they happen, will you be calling the Lord a liar? Or will you be like, God is with me? God is with me. Because, you see, Satan is given short time to do all he has to do to deceive this world. And that's why all these things are happening, because the final, we can call it the final conflict, if you will, which, you know, will be a very short conflict, because there's no way that Satan's going to win anyway, because Jesus has already won. It's finished, you know? But he's going to try anyway, but he's going to try to take as many souls with him as possible into the lake of fire, because that's where his end will be. And so, in a mindset of, who can I bring with me? Lord, give me a chance to witness today. Give me a chance to do your work. Or if you're expecting an audible voice from the Lord all the time or something like that, you know, sometimes, you know, you just need to get up and say, I'm going to do something for you. He doesn't always have to tell you, go do this, go do that. There are good things that I'm pretty sure with you being saved that you can think of doing. Everybody's called to go street preach. I get that. Not everybody's called for that. But we're called to love our enemies, love our neighbors. The love that you give off to people in Christ will draw them to you and give you an opportunity to witness to them. And where is your focus? Is your focus on destruction coming to this world, or is it on getting people saved, serving the Lord, glorifying God, worshiping Him? Which one is it? Like I said, there's nothing wrong with studying Bible prophecy and the things to come and these other things that are going on in the midst of all this other thing. Nothing wrong with that. But if that's your whole focus, then you're getting misled into, you know, into not doing what you're called to do. He didn't say, go and study everything that's going to happen to the world. No, he said, go out and preach the gospel to every creature.
Amen.
And that's one of our purpose here at Don't Let Them Burn. We're here to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ while exposing the darkness that's out there. The twofold thing going on here. You see, we have all of these entertainers. You have the Drakes and the Lil Waynes and the Miley Cyrus, and you go on and on and on, leading our generation astray. And it's not just hip-hop, it's other forms of music too. And some of us have a duty to reach out to that community. And others have a duty to reach out to other communities. We all function in different ways. But are we using our talents, using our the things that we're able to do to lead people
the gift that God has given us
to the world? The gift that is given, yes, to reach the world. You see, we can get encouraged in that. What can I do for Jesus? What can I do
Amen.
For the Lord? You know, because even if you're getting thrown into jail today, you have an opportunity to witness. You know why? You're not dead. You have an opportunity to witness in jail. If you get into a car wreck,
people there
you're
need
still
Jesus.
Alive, you have the opportunity to witness to a paramedic or a nurse or a doctor. See, we have opportunities all around us. It's just for us to see the opportunity. Or, you know, maybe God will give us that little spiritual push. Talk to this man. Something like that. You know? You'll hear the little still, the Bible calls it the little still voice. Not something that's loud and monstrous in your head, but you'll get the push. Talk to this person. Or hand out a Bible tract. Or start a radio show. Something. Something. Because the time is close for the hammer to drop on this world and, you know, this whole 7-year tribulation, great tribulation, I'm going to say. You know, some people confuse tribulation with the regular tribulation. So I'm going to say the great tribulation. We're not in the great tribulation yet. So before that happens, don't you want to reach out to somebody, even a family friend or something? Be encouraged in that. I'm pretty sure that in every family, we have a lot of unsaved people. Every family.
And not only God that, calls. We can also pray for them.
Oh, yes, pray.
We can also start praying for them. Pray
mm-hmm.
for them.
Yeah.
Pray that they come and
Even
understand,
that, yeah.
to an understanding who Jesus Christ is. That's important.
Yeah. And in fact, going back to what I said a minute ago, all these stars that are leading people, just pray for them. They're people, too. I don't look at
yes.
any of them higher than me. They're just people led astray by the devil or their own imagination or whatever it is, you know? And, you know, the Bible says the devil blinds the minds of the children of disobedience. You know?
Yeah.
He works in the children of, his work is getting carried out by them. And some of them don't know it. Some of them. Some of them know exactly what they're doing. But we could pray for them too. We could pray for our leaders.
They're in the darkness.
There's a whole lot of ways for us to function in this whole body of Christ, the whole movement of preaching the gospel and getting out to a lost world that's going to hell every day. People are dying and going to hell every day. And part of it's our lack of doing something.
Amen.
You don't reach out. We had opportunities to reach out to people that were around for 5 years, 1 year, 30 minutes, you know? And we never took the opportunity. We never asked the question. We never opened the conversation, opened the dialogue to speak to them, myself included. So I'm not throwing a stone at somebody, and I didn't do that. I'm guilty too, you know? So we have to keep that in our head that we have a mission here. We are, like the Bible says, we're not our own. We're bought with a price, you know? We can't just act any way we want to act and think it's all good. We're bought with a price. We're accountable to the Lord. I mean, I don't want to be one of those people that says, look at all these people you could have witnessed to. The Lord shows you that when you're in front of him. And you're like, oh my goodness, really? All those people I could have witnessed to? I don't want to be one of those people. I'm probably already one of those people. But, you know?
Yeah.
You want to work with zealousness.
Be diligent.
God. I didn't hear you. Sorry.
I'm saying being diligent with the thing that God has called us to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Because a lot of us come out of different backgrounds, different social experiences. And some experiences I may not be able to understand, but you can, and you can relate to people on your end that have been through the same thing. That's why God called you out of that, because now you can expose it. Or you can relate to somebody going through that and then help pull them out of the fire. I grew up listening to all this crazy music, went to the club, did rap, did all these things. Now I can relate to people that are doing that. I could expose some of that thing, some of those things. So,
amen.
Or you might have lived a simple life, and God called you. Maybe he called you to serve in the church. Something, do something that's going to mean something by the end of your life, and not worry too much about the things to come. Because whether you die or get raptured, you're going to be with the Lord. Either way. But are you going to go there with nothing accomplished for the Lord? Not for yourself, for the Lord.
And stand
before
him empty-handed.
Empty-handed, exactly. You know? So yeah, we need to think about these things in these times. And, you know, we can't go back to the past. You know? Everything, every second that clicks, that's the future. We're walking into the future every second that goes away, you know? So what are you going to do? Just reach somebody for eternal purposes. Not to put a check mark on, I won 5 this day and 10 that day. No. But caring about people, really. Caring about people and their souls. This whole movement. There's so many movements going on. I'm not even going to call out one right now. So many movements. Evil movements. And
that seems like they have a good cause.
Yeah, some of them seem like it's a good cause. But the Word of God says no. No, no, no.
There's a way that seems right unto a man and the end is destruction.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of people out there doing some wicked things and think they're doing righteous acts. They think they're working for God. Or they just think they're doing something good for the world. But they're leading people into hell. Same way. Where do we go from here? Where do we go from? When are we going to start to wake up to the reality that God has much more in store for us than we think, just by trusting Him. Trusting Him. Walking with Him. Studying His Word. And just living by it. If we were to live what the Bible teaches, we wouldn't be gossiping. We wouldn't be, over here causing trouble, or over there doing what we're not supposed to do. We would be in a better position, I should say. Because you're already in a good position if you're saved. But you would be in a better position if you're living by the Word of God. Not just hearing it, So, just want to bear that in mind, because this is the encouragement we have.
Amen.
There's nothing mystical or magical about trusting the Lord. It's really simple. But if we trust and lean on our flesh alone, it becomes complicated.
And it won't work.
Exactly. Because we'll say all of the pretty things that we have to say about God, but I see it, certain situations, and even in some of my situations, So it's just focusing on Jesus. I'm going to let you run for a minute, Rory. Go ahead.
Well, I listened to what you said, how important it is for us to follow and do the things that God has called us to do, each and every one. We can't lose heart. We can't lose our focus. Our focus is Christ and Christ alone. And to draw people to Him, to share the Word of God, the living God, with people. And a lot of times, Chris, I think about the Word of God. I think about the naysayers and what they're saying, and why there should be separation of church and state. And I look at all of these things and I say, but what is so offensive in the Word of God? Is it the Ten Commandments? No. Those are principles that every man should live by. Whatever is yours is yours. And whatever, honor God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and you love your neighbor as yourself. These are the things that he said. He said this to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and they were upset. And we look at it today, and the people are still upset. There's nothing in the Word, in God's Word, that is so wrong, that is so bad. And what it brings me to think is there a country in the world that maybe the leaders of the country said, we are going to follow God. We're going to take His Word. And we're going to follow His Word. Is there a family today that says, we're going to take His Word. We're going to follow the Word of God. And we're going to do everything that it tells us to do. Is there an individual that says, I'm going to follow the Word of God. And I'm going to do everything that it tells me to do. I think about that, and why I say that is because the Word of God is so rich. It is powerful. It is sharper than every two-edged sword. And it's there for the individual to save them. It's the only thing that can bring you from the destruction of hell. It's the only thing. There's nothing else. And men see the hand of God in their lives and in everything around them. But men would rather say, no, we're going to try to see if we can find the God particle. We are going to try and see if we can do this. We are going to try and see if we can do that. And they look and they see and they know the things that are created is created by God, God alone. It's only by the hand of God. He's the one that does the things that He does. It's only by His hand, by His grace, and by His mercy. And Once you take a pledge that you're going to follow God's word, that you're going to do everything that his word says, you have to share the word of God. You got to. Because if you don't, you don't love. And then Christ is not in you. Christ is in us. And he is the hope of our glory. That one day he's coming back. And he's going to come back and break the cloud. And then far and wide will wonder and say, my goodness, if I only had known that it was true. You know, if I had only taken it for what it was and looked for myself and not listened to anyone else, just so that it was true. Folks, he's real. He has done so many things in my life to change my life for the better. It's most amazing. Some of you are involved in other things that are not right, that don't line up with the word of God. And you know beyond a shadow of a doubt there's a power that's greater. And his name is Jesus. And the Bible says, at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There is a day that's coming. There is a day that's coming where every man, every woman, every child, they will have to give an account for everything that's done in the body. Everything that's done in their body. Yes, we have 24 hours a day. I can't remember how many minutes. And how we just waste the time away. Some of us just waste our time and don't devote to anything. But Jesus Christ is there, and he's asking you, what are you doing with your life? I'm quite sure if people found out tomorrow morning that they could make $5 million, how many people would jump on it? They would jump on it, they would call their family members and tell them, and look, there's a way that every man, woman, and child could be saved. Are you willing to share? Would you share and tell someone, hey, listen, this is the word of God. It's serious. This is true. Trust me on this. You got to, this is it. This is it. This is going to set you free. This is going to set you free. This is going to revolutionize your life. This is going to make you come from the bottom and come to the top spiritually. This is what I'm talking about. This is what I've been doing. This is the word of God. This is true. This, the word says, who the Son set free is free indeed. You got to trust me on this, Mom. You got to trust me on this, Dad. You got to trust me on this, Sis. You got to trust me on this, Friend. This is what we're called to do. It's to share the living word of God with people. And Chris, you know, people got to be encouraged. Like you said, be encouraged. Share the word. Don't look at what's going on so much around you. That's important. But the word is so much more important. It's so much more. And God says, he's going to be there. I'm not going to leave you nor forsake you. Even in the last days, men will lose heart. They'll lose heart. Men will want to kill themselves. Men are going to want to do all sorts of other things. But focus on the Lord. Renew your strength. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Lord God, help us not to be fearful in these times, but to hold on firmly to you, dear Lord God, to do the things that you've called us to do right now. And Lord God, I even want to pray to take away the doubt from people's minds that, Lord, they will come to a new understanding of who you are, that they will know who you are and be set free from the tyranny of the enemy. Amen. Just thank you, Lord. Praise you. My dear brother Chris.
Yes, sir. A couple of articles here. The lady that got arrested, her name is Kim Davis. She, jailed because of her beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned that earlier, but I didn't have her name. That's her name, Kim Davis. And here she is, a believer, thrown into prison. And hopefully she has the joy of the Lord. Hopefully she isn't distressed over the whole thing. Because he just told us that these things would happen. They would happen. You know? And I didn't get to hear exactly everything that you said. I'm pretty sure the listeners did, but you're breaking up through the connection that I have with you. But it's just crazy. Some of the things I'm looking at right now. That's why you hear me stuttering a little bit. I just want to report on one little thing I see here. As here is, there's certain shoes out there. I know this is just a weird thing to bring up all of a sudden at the last minute or so, but there's shoes out there that look like horse hoofs or hoofs of the goddess, the god Pan, the demon god Pan. Female shoes that look like this thing. Where is this world going to? You know? I mean, really. It's just weird to look at this right now. I mean, I probably just send you this through the email, but...
Well, wait a minute. Before you even go, you talk about hooves. You talk about hooves. And FIFA, in the new video game FIFA, I think it's 2015, they were talking about the same hooves. Like he hoofed that out or something to that effect. And they were talking about how it refers to the goat of Mendes, the hoofs.
Yeah.
And how they're using even these terms, these things, these shoes, to spread this propaganda of death to people who are unsuspecting. Word of God says, for lack of knowledge, people perish.
Yeah.
And that is so true.
Yeah. Yeah. And just to see these people eat this up. So the moral of the decline, I mean, even in fashion. We haven't even did a whole show on fashion. But anyway, it's just weird. And then the weirder it gets, the more demonic it gets. And that's why we have to be on guard. Because just imagine, you know, and I'm not saying the woman can't wear heels. I'm not saying that when I bring this up. But the people the women that used to wear the heels were the hookers, you know? And we've assimilated that idea into common culture now. And here comes these hooved heel shoes. They don't even have heels per se. You just walk in the hooves. Just imagine what's going on in the background of manufacturers. This can't be a rational person doing this. Because obviously it would hurt somebody's feet by the time they finish walking on their toes like that. But, you know, just seeing the weirdness that's going on in this world. We can't get off guard by the thing that the culture will push on us. We have to be prepared spiritually, always. We can get caught up in the HDTV, 4K, 8K, 100K, all this stuff, but there's a purpose to all of that. And it's documented. You know? The Alpha Wave and all this other stuff. You know, that's for another show, but people don't understand how most of these things are just, there's an agenda behind them. And so we got to worry about, not worry, but think about these things. Then we got to think about the things that are coming and then the thing that might happen tomorrow. But be calm, because Jesus will never leave you.
And you love
Jesus
this
will never leave you. Turn and love this culture or love this world. The Bible says, whoever is the lover of this world is an enemy of God. You don't want to be God's enemy.
Amen.
So, you know, again, just want to encourage you to read your Bible more, to trust the Lord more, see what he says about trusting him. Go look into the word. This stuff is easy to find. Not Google, but look it up on the internet, and verses on encouragement will flood your page, okay? You will see
the other thing
that,
is that
Lord. Go ahead.
I just want to encourage people, you can go see that movie, War Room. It's a really,
really check that out.
Very good movie for the whole family. Very good, great movie for people to go see. I'm one that's, I tend to be very skeptical of movies. And when I saw this one, it was very good, very well paid. And it was funny.
Yeah.
And it teaches us something that we need to get back on our knees and start praying and trusting in the Lord.
Yeah. Amen. I need to go check that out. I just want to thank you for tuning in tonight. Don't forget you can check us out on www.don'tletthemburn.com, Twitter and Facebook. And, you know, just stay encouraged and seek the Lord. Good night.
Good night, everyone. God bless. God bless and Godspeed. Keep the faith. Don't lose it.